Welcome to episode 4 of Policy Matters, an early childhood policy video chat series produced by the McCormick Center for Early Childhood Leadership at National Lewis University. This episode features Terry Tallon of the McCormick Center and Susan Oxhorn of ECE Policy Works. In this episode, Terry and Susan dialogue on their perspectives of whole leadership.
Welcome to our policy video chat. I'm really excited to be here with Susan Oxhorn. I'm Terry Tallon, and we're going to be discussing the topic of whole leadership today. So I will just going to get us started, Susan, by saying that the McCormick Center has been engaged in a really exciting endeavor exploring the concept of whole leadership. And people are familiar with the whole child. You've written a lot about the importance of the whole child. And I'd like to ask you to start by saying, what comes to your mind when I say to you whole leadership?
What comes to mind is the whole child. And we're sort of, you know, as we've been charting this kind of a, I hope it's going to be a movement or an initiative to really look at the whole child, leadership has to be in sync with that. So that means really being very attuned to kids' social emotional development, their cultural and racial and, you know, backgrounds, whether or not they live in poverty, you know, what are the factors that have an impact on their ability to learn well and develop. Looking at health, also looking at the way they are in their communities. So a whole leader is somebody who is really kind of embodies all of those things and needs to be kind of connected in that ecosystem.
So I think when I think about whole child, I think about the fact that we really want policy folk to be cognizant that all of children's development is really key to have the kinds of healthy development that we want for young children. And we all know that policymakers sometimes like things simple, like one simple single ingredient to focus on. So by focusing on the whole child, and yet that's a clear-cut concept, it helps policymakers deal with the reality that all of children's development, cognitive, social, emotional, attitudes towards learning are important. At the McCormick Center, we were responding to the fact that our space, early childhood program leadership, which has been our space for 30 plus years, right, has suddenly become of interest to policymakers and people very broadly. And yet, we were concerned that the concept of what it takes to be really effective as a program leader could easily run that same dangerous path of saying, oh, we know instructional leadership is important and focusing there without realizing that's so important, but it's only one piece of what's important.
Exactly.
So we jumped on the bandwagon, really, of thinking whole child communicates something immediately, and whole leadership hopefully does the same.
I think it does, Terry. You know, we started a series of whole child Twitter chats. Mm-hmm. And in the process, I have met a lot of people who are really, really embody what McCormick is looking at as whole leadership. David Adderholt, who is a superintendent in the Princeton area of New Jersey, he really sees social emotional development as very, very important. Jamal Bowman, who's here in New York City where I live, he's principal of and founding principal of a middle school. And he really sees all the whole child is very important. And he's working with kids who are in poverty and children of color mostly. Then there are others. There's a Maryland principal who's working, not a principal, superintendent, whose name I don't remember. But so in any event, I think that it's already out there. And the exciting thing is that early childhood, I mean, as we've talked about before, you know, has the space that you're in and that early childhood educators are in is perfect. It's like the perfect storm for, you know, really starting a conversation about what it looks like.
Right. And I just want to, like, another piece that I think is really critical right now is getting people involved so that this, and I think of Stacy Gothin and the important work Stacy has done around having the field be involved in defining what the profession looks like and who's in this profession, what are the competencies, and how do we self-monitor and direct the profession and be responsible for what it is committed to doing and take responsibility for it. Same thing for program leaders. We have many people on the outside who want to define what an effective program leader is, but we haven't had a lot of tapping into the incredible knowledge base of program leaders themselves. So one of the things we've been doing with our series of blogs is really pushing program leaders in the field to think deeply about the concept of whole leadership. Is it instructional leadership? Is it pedagogical leadership? Is it administrative leadership? Is it operational? Are these the right terms? What else is critical to our work? So it's understanding that we don't want one single ingredient. We really want program leaders to be engaged in this, defining what this work is and setting the standard. So just the same as we've engaged teachers in identifying what's important for the whole child, that's what we're trying to do at the McCormick Center around whole leadership.
I love your blog, and I've been reading it avidly. It's great. I remember reading something in one of the blogs about a kind of authenticity. Mm-hmm. And yes, you need to be a whole leader, program leader needs to be very up to speed on all of the infrastructure and the management and all of those things. But there needs to be also a real appreciation of sort of the whole little ecosystem of the setting, right? You know, right. And that's so totally analogous to what we're talking about with kids, right? We're looking at them in their ecosystem. The other thing that I think is important is that part of that authenticity needs to involve advocacy and really, really relating and connecting for collective impact with others in the community who are working with kids and families.
That's one of the questions that one of our readers and responders on the blog brought up. Where does advocacy fit in for effective leaders? And, you know, is this an aspect of leadership that needs to be called out on its own? Is it a part of administrative leadership? Is it everybody's professional responsibility? But I like the fact that we're beginning the conversation about where it fits and highlighting it as a part of leadership, because, you know, program leaders are internally focused at making sure their organizations are running smoothly, but if they're not focused on the outside in the communities that they're situated in and the state and federal environments, then they are always reacting to things being done to them. So a truly effective leader needs to be able to be outward focused as well and think strategically, think systemically. And that's what some of our readers have been highlighting.
I'm so glad to hear that. You know, I have done some work with Naomi Karp and LaVon DeVille at United Way in Tucson, Southern Arizona. And this was exactly what they had this really groundbreaking professional development initiative, which is very much, you know, very much in sync with what you all are doing at McCormick. And the idea was, what we really focused on was talking about connections in the community, really fostering those kind of links to nonprofits, to policymakers, to, you know, institutions, other institutions of higher ed, to, you know, libraries, to health organizations, you know, all of the, you know, the building blocks of a child's ecosystem have to be part of this, the leader's, you know, toolbox, really. Right. I don't see it as separate, really. from, administrative leadership, I guess you could say technically needs to be sort of in its own place, but it is a responsibility. It is one of NAYC's professional standards, advocacy is.
And I think people have certain assumptions. What is administrative leadership? Recently I was looking at that term and think of it in terms of both strategic leadership and operational. So oftentimes that strategic, where I see the policy and community building and the community systems building work, is part of that strategic leadership. It doesn't get addressed. And if you think about how leaders are prepared, there's so little attention to that aspect of what an effective leader needs to know and be able to do. So I think this is going to have, hopefully, major impact for the preparation of leaders moving forward. Once we really tease out, or as my colleague Mike Abel put it, deconstruct program leadership, I think then we're really going to be able to try to work with higher ed and other institutions to make sure those competencies are getting addressed.
I love it. I think it has such potential. And also, you know, Terry, there really isn't another alternative, given, you know, how interconnected we are, given the very, you know, sort of holistic way that we're viewing the child, that we see development and early learning. You know, it's just like a no-brainer. It has to happen. So
I want to take it back to policy, though, for a moment, okay? And I know from work that I do with national advocates that there's been so much effort at addressing the needs of having high quality, well-qualified teachers, that there's been a reluctance to say we need to have a similar focus on leaders. And because in some way it's perceived as there's a finite amount of resources and we don't have enough to go around to focus on having well-qualified leaders. What would your response be to that?
If you don't have well-qualified leaders, you're not going to have terrific, well-qualified teachers. That's, that's my response. I think that's suicidal, really. It makes no sense to me. I don't understand that. We all know that the resources for professional development of the early childhood workforce are really inadequate, and there has to be a way. We have to do, it has to be both, and they can't be separate, and there needs to be equal, they need to be equally funded and invested in.
Then this gets back to the advocating and to the role of the leader in the community and in policy shaping. And if leaders have, you know, it, as part of their professional responsibility to advocate for their staff and for children and families, then that's the way it's going to happen. It has to be something that's really organic. But it's not going to happen if they are isolated in their settings and are not really engaged for collective impact in the community. They have to find peers and other colleagues in other systems that serve children and families and in other institutions and with other stakeholders in the community, both locally in the state and yes, on the federal level, but locally is really, really important, I would say.
So as my grandmother used to say, from your lips to God's ear, right? Equal funding for the professional development of effective leaders needs to be on the agenda of policymakers, along with, not instead of, but along with well-qualified and supported and compensated teachers. Thank you, Susan, for joining the conversation. I hope you'll put some of your comments on our blogs and look forward to having you join in this continuing conversation about whole leadership.
Thank you, Terry. It's been a pleasure.